Okay, I have a few more questions from these people. Samo303 says this. You've been playing instrumental music for years and years. Do you ever feel you've taken it as far as you can go, and how do you combat that if you do?
Oh, no, I think there's no really boundary for, you know, the genre itself. I really think it's really up to the creativity of each of the artists. There's so much to write about, and that's the real scary part is the quality of writing, because you can't practice it, I don't think. Mm. I mean, if someone shows you a lick and it's hard, you practice it, you learn it, and you can do it. And so the mechanical part is not the difficult part. Mm. I mean, I always have faith that, like most musicians, if given enough time, we can get it down. But how do you come up with a great idea?
Yeah, I mean, I remember Steve Vai saying that if you want to play like me, play like yourself, because that's what I'm doing. Don't try and play like me, play like yourself.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, there are many contexts in the music industry, and I respect that when people ask me questions like that, because for someone whose job is to be in a cover band or to play at social functions, it's a really good question. To just focus on technique and how do I make that sound, because that's my job. Mm-hmm. You know, when I go and I play at the local bar, or I'm playing at a wedding or something, and I'm supposed to play this, you know, summer song or something, I just want to know how you do it so mm-hmm. I can get on with my job, you know. So I respect that, and a musician like that provides a great service to people who need musicians, yeah. You know. So we should be able to answer their questions directly and say, it was this guitar, it was that wah-wah pedal, and this is how I make that noise, by picking over here, you know. But my job is different. It's quite different. Mm. It really relies on composition, writing new songs to move people. And then once I get to that stage, then the other part of me that, you know, puts his fingers on the guitar really starts to go to work trying to come up with interesting ways to record it, to make it a reality. But without the idea or the inspiration to write the songs I do, I'm just sort of like anybody else. You know, just I happen to have a fair amount of technique. But without my songs, I feel like I'm sort of adrift in a way.
Right, right. You know? I mean, I think you've got the you're a composer, you're a performer, and you're also a teacher. Mm-hmm. What do you think of yourself as? Most of all, or is it something else?
Just trying to be a human being like the rest of us.
Now, do you think your music has? You were talking about how you know, your thought goes into music and that they're compositional. Has your approach to composition changed at all?
Well, I think that every time I finish working on a record, it represents a very intense period of not only introspection, but also bringing, you know, hopefully all the stuff that I've been taught ever since I was a kid about music, all to the front, so I can, you know, of my consciousness, so I can use it. I can use the tools that people have taken the time to show me, you know, and to teach me. And so you walk away thinking, in various instances, like with different pieces of music, that you've gone a little further because you finally used something. Mm-hmm. Maybe a compositional technique. Maybe you thought you could never use a suspension in a certain way over a chord with a melody. Maybe you learn that you can be even more vague and still wind up with a powerful result. Mm-hmm. That I think is a recurring thing, because I relate to music that's very that has less structure as opposed to a lot of structure. I found in high school that it was so easy to write complex music. And you get out a piece of manuscript paper, you get a pen, and you just fill up that page and you hand it to someone who says they can play anything. And suddenly, you know, you're that far away from being a genius because you've written this difficult piece. Mm. But I mean, a child could fill up the manuscript paper with dots and lots of unusual rhythms. But it always left me cold. I never got off on it. I never was impressed by it. Everyone else in my class could do it. So I thought, well, but what are we writing? You know, what is this? Is this music going to survive for hundreds of years? Is it going to be played at somebody's wedding in 5 years? You know, are they going to chant it at a football stadium? You know what I mean? Whose song will it become? That's what I want to know. And I guess I started realizing that the songs that I really loved were not complicated. Mm. They were bold, they were strong, they were serious, but they weren't filled up with all sorts of, you know, stuff. Mm. So then the question is, well, what are they doing? How are they doing it? That was my big question to my high school music teacher, was what makes it work? How come the Moonlight Sonata is so amazing and it's so slow? Mm. You know, there's no orchestration or anything, you know.
It's in the tune.
It's in the magic in the tune. And you know, the musicians say a lot of things. Well, it's the space between the notes. It's, you know, there's a lot of euphemisms and funny maxims. But ultimately, it's art. That's what it is. And so you have to tap into that, I think.
This cameraman actually played a Joe Satriani song at my wedding. Did you know that?
Is that right?
Yeah.
Fantastic. Thank you. How did it go? Oh, I should say, how did it go over?
It went down very well.
It wasn't Hill of the Skull or something like that, was it?
It was Always With Me, Always With You. And then we did Satch Boogie as a duo.
Oh, wow. Fantastic.
Right. So, how good. One more question then. Have you ever written, this is Cellos Killers, okay. Have you ever written a tune that once played back made you think, whoa, did I really write that?
Well, yes, I mean, you know, it's funny, when we're out on tour, one of the cool things about it is that I get to face the song again and again, right after night. Because the recordings are like your first attempt at dealing with what you've written. Mm-hmm. And generally the fingers are completely young at trying to play the song, you know, and you guys mentioned Satch Boogie. I mean, I barely played that song when we recorded it, and somehow we got it recorded. Got it recorded in a day. And for the rest of my career, I've been playing it and looking at my guitar going, now, can I do this any differently? Like, why did I do it that way that day? And everyone's relating to it like that, but there's so many ways to do it. And I wish I had more time to really to work on it. So there's that. But then I think the dark side of that question is that sometimes you listen to stuff that you've recorded and you go, oh, that's horrible. I can't believe I've written that.
But you have a chance to do it again live, so.
Well, you know, we don't do those songs. But there's always something. I mean, I had this thing I was trying to do maybe about a year ago. I thought, I got to get a talk box, you know. A lot of people have songs where they use a talk box. And I try to avoid signature sounds that other people use, but I just was so curious about doing it. And I bought one from Peter Frampton, has a company in the US, and so I bought one of his talk boxes, which is really well thought out. The thing works great. And I'd had some experience with them before, and I've always hated having something in my mouth, and you know, with the saliva, and then it rattles your fillings, and it's, the whole thing is just horrible, you know. And I play harmonica, and that's disgusting enough, you know, to have to put your mouth on that thing every night. But I thought I'd give it a try. You know, some people have had huge hits with this thing, you know, and maybe I just need to get personal with it. And so one afternoon I got all excited and I wrote this song and I recorded it. And the next day I turned it on and I hated it. I just hated it. And it was, I asked myself, you know, it's sort of like what the question was putting forth, which is, were you ever amazed at what you've written? And I was amazed at how bad it was.
Yeah.
It just sounded like someone who had just gotten a new toy, right?
And dreadful.
Plugged it in and didn't read the instructions or something.
You played the Expo 92 with Joe Walsh. I remember him playing a talk box on that concert. That was great. Okay, well, I think that we have come to the end of our discussion. Thank you very much for talking to us. And I just have to announce that the winner of the Spot the Beamer competition, where the cameraman was driving around with his BMW with this on the back of it.
Oh, wow, look at that.
So the winner, who had to phone a number, is Stephen Scooter, who is going to get free tickets to tonight's concert.
All right, Stephen.
Yeah.
It's a little late, but...
he's at the door already.
He knows he's won.
Okay, so many thanks.
Thank you very much.
Right, cheers.
Thanks.